For today we come to celebrate, as well as mourn, the life and death of Tim. I want to welcome you all, whether you come far or near. Some have come all the way from Korea, the East, and the States in the West. I hope that we can bring fond memories of Tim and celebrate who and what he was, as well as saying goodbye. There will be a committal at South London Crematorium in Rowan Road. That will be at 4 o'clock. That will be for friends and family. You're allowed to shed a tear, but also to love and fond memory as well. Both are allowed. Above all, the reason why we're here is to remember that Tim had that relationship with his Lord and Saviour, who was the utmost importance to him in his life, in the life of his family and friends here. And so, let us open with this prayer. God, your love is stronger than death. By you we are being brought to life. Help us to hear the promises of your word, to believe them and to receive the comfort they offer. You are the giver of hope. Fill us with joy and peace and believing that our fears may be dispelled, our loneliness eased, our hope reawakened through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're now going to come to our first hymn, and it's Hope by Hope. Shows and blots who Tim is in his Christian faith. So I'm going to ask you to stand if you're able to. The words are here, but they can come up on the screen if you need larger words. So let us stand if you're able and sing.
Thank you. I'm now going to ask Elizabeth and Jonathan to bring their tribute.
This is our family tribute to our brother Tim. We hope it will show a little of his life before ministry and marriage, and perhaps how he became the man he was. I'm less than 18 months older than Tim, and my earliest memory was of him crying with rage, as my father had removed the outriders from my little bicycle to stop him riding off from it. He was not amused. Later, of course, he became a wonderfully calm and controlled man. Most important about the young Tim was his love of cricket, which lasted his whole life. I often thought he learned to read from Wisdom, the cricketer's almanac. His birthday in August meant he could have cricketing birthday parties to which friends and family all came. And later, my father put up cricket nets in the garden. We used to practice together in the back garden, and our father, a very good cricketer in his youth, also came out to bowl to us. Aged 11, he went to University College School in Hampstead, where he added rugby to his sporting loves.
At UCS, Tim was put in the fast treatment in the age group ahead, which meant studying Latin and ancient Greek, so he showed academic prowess even in those days. Although I think sport was always his great love, his teams and beyond, making the school first teams in both rugby and cricket. Despite the 3-year age difference and my early propensity to annoy him to the point of violence, not something I remember on my dad, but I wasn't scarred by it. He became the best big brother, and as well as cricket in the back garden, we went together to rugby internationals at Twickenham. He helped me with my science homework, so it was a great disappointment when he went to Warwick University and the quality of my homework went downhill. Later on, we both played cricket and rugby for the school old boys team, and I remember his delight when he told me that he had scored 100 runs for his cricket team, a credit as a concentration.
I don't think it was until Timothy went to university that he really became interested in Christianity, and he joined the Navigators with a friend. He studied molecular science at Warwick, but ultimately decided the scientific life wasn't for him, so he took up accountancy after graduating. I'm not sure he ever really liked that either, but it did give him the opportunity to work in Zambia, which I think was life-changing, especially being held up at gunpoint, and led to his ministry later. But Tim was not all about sport and faith. His sense of humour showed in his appreciation of peanuts, a comic strip, though he did like eating peanuts too. He took great delight in the meaning of life, which he was able to quote extensively. And he relished the humour of the comedy singing duo Flange and Swan, famous to our generation for their song about mud and hippos. They will be celebrated in the music at the Krem. I recently discovered that he used to tease Sung Yee by singing Tom Lehrer's rather macabre song, I Hold Your Hand in Mine, Dear, to keep her awake while driving. Had a wicked sense of humour. I'm afraid I introduced Tom Lehrer to him in our teens. He was able to combine so many passions and interests, but it is with his ministry and love and devotion to some people that it is that he will be most remembered. That devotion was repaid in spades by some people in the last years of his life. And we know he touched many people's lives as he helped them through their own challenges.
next hymn is In Christ Alone. How can you begin to get a real flavour of who and what Tim was? And very much in Christ alone, his faith was standing. So let's all stand, those who are able to, and sing.
Now go to God's born Jericho Polo, former prince of all nations, to bring his tribute. Then I will be impressed that by Anthony Billington, all done that God has.
On our behalf, I wish to convey our deepest condolences to ask his brother, the Reverend Dr. Sun Kyung Kwon, and his siblings. Elizabeth mentioned that Tim worked in Zambia after qualifying in accountancy. That's where I met him. I served with the Scripture Union, and somebody at Manor Northwood had recommended it to Tim that when he got to this strange country, he should look for the Scripture Union, and he was sure he'd get supportive fellowship there. And so he found us, and he became a member of our congregation and deeply got involved in all the things we did in that church. Like him, I too lost my car at gunpoint, but not of the same night. But I do remember that the next day I was standing and I heard he'd lost his car the night before, and I saw a policeman driving his car. And so I walked up to the policeman. I was standing in a Christian institution, and the police had picked up his car. They'd seen evidence that this man was a Christian. And so they went to this Christian institution to see if anybody knew who he was and where he did. So we went over, a friend of mine and I, and we said, you know, he wanted his car, you know, it was taken off him at the end of last night. And they said, but you can take it to him. And so we did share that difficult moment with him. While in Kitwe, the city in which we lived, Tim encouraged us to form a reading club. He would have liked us to read Three Men in a Book. But we overruled him. Instead, we read The Abolition of Man by C.S. Lewis, and one or two other books written by the great author. He returned to the UK in the autumn of 79. I think just a month before I came to the UK, I came to study at London Bible College. And as we were talking about relocating to the UK, and I told him what my plans were, he said to me, well, I will see you because my parents live about just over a mile away from LBC. And so it was that I introduced him to the college, and he would come regularly. And in time, his house, when he moved out of his parents' home, became an extension of my extracurricular activities. He was very generous in letting us use his home. We had committee meetings there and other social activities. Now, thus, his involvement with London Bible College continued more significantly. Long after I had left, he enrolled in the college to do a degree in theology. Followed that up with an MTH at London University, and then, of course, ultimately a PhD from South Wales, Lampeter. Tim became a member of that very small and elite group of human beings who actually added original human knowledge to our understanding, in this case of theology. A great achievement. And until he fell ill, went to hospital, he taught regularly at CMS in Oxford, and he successfully led many students to complete their PhD studies. All the while, Tim and Sun Yi have been involved in family prayers. A ministry they appreciate the wisdom of this preacher's and the lack of Christian fellowship. He was ordained in South Korea. I said to Sunhee, what are your happiest memories of your late husband? And she beamed. And there are lots of things, but this is one that that I shared with her, that Elizabeth mentioned. His sense of humor was wicked. He laughed at his own jokes, which sometimes in Zambia was a bit odd, because very few of us understood what the humor was. But once he started laughing, we couldn't help joining. So we did. I think if he'd chosen to be a stand-up comic, he would have been very successful. When Sunhee was seriously considering marriage, she asked the Lord for a man who was steeped in theology. This is before she met him. Steeped in theology, who loved foreigners and who enjoyed curry. But Tim satisfied all three criteria perfectly. He was a very generous man, and certainly to me. In the holidays, when the college threw us out, he always offered me a room in his house. And when my wife found out that I got married, I was in Zambia, and he said to me, well, come back to London and pick up a car and take it to Northern Ireland, where I got married. And he was very generous in that way, but it wasn't just with physical things like accommodation and a car and so on. I know at least one former LBC student who, even just 2 weeks ago, said that if she hadn't had Tim alongside, she wouldn't have passed her exams. Jonathan has already alluded to Tim's generosity in that sense. As we know, he was a very keen Christian, but apart from cricket, rugby, and squash, I could never beat him at squash. We played many, many games, and he always came top. I hope when I join him in heaven, we will have a rematch, because I will be perfect. He will be able to beat me. Yeah, a very keen Christian from the moment a fellow student at Warwick University led him to the Lord. Oh, the strangest of things, it was the song Bridge Over Troubled Water, in which he was terribly interested. The guy who was thinking to lead him to the Lord heard the song wafting over the wells, and it was distracting them. But actually, it was what Tim needed to hear at that point. Jesus is the bridge over troubled water. And that clinched it for him. M to the Lord, as they say, the rest is history. He is survived by wife, son, and family, siblings, as well. And he's so
as we pray, let me invite us to listen to some words from the Bible. These were written by someone who was grieving, but who expressed the source of their hope in God. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his passions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Let's have a short moment of quiet where we can each bring our own prayers to the Lord. We want to do so, and I will lead us in this prayer together. Lord God, we thank you for a life well lived in love of you and service to us, and for having grateful memories that different ones of us will carry on. Lord, we grieve your words out to us that our grief isn't hopeless, because we can be confident of your faithfulness in all things, including death. But we commit you all those who will miss you. Pray for Elizabeth and Jonathan and other family members as they each wrestle with the grief of bereavement. Lord, please make yourself present to them in their sadness. Give them the comfort only you can give, even as they support one another. But we pray especially for Sunday. Thank you for the relationship she's enjoyed, for the fruitful ministry they exercised together, and for the love and dedication Sunday was able to share with us over this last season. May she know your peace in the stillness of the day and the stretches of the night. Be with her, Lord, in her sorrow, uphold her with your strength, through the love shared by us. Keep her confident of your goodness in all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The family have chosen a number of readings today, which we hope reflects who Mark Tim was, his core beliefs. And the first reading is going to be brought by Karen Pollock from Tim's own church at Manual in Norwood. And then after Karen has read that reading, that's what us, Paul and the family.
This reading is from Philippians chapter 1, verses 14 to 24. Because of my dreams, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly. It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. That will do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out to my goodness. I eagerly expect to hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage, so that now as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labour for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. It is more necessary for you that I remain in the body.
to the Jonathan, Reverend Joe, share in your loss together today. And we offer you our sympathies and our condolences. Thank you for inviting me to bring God's word to us this afternoon. Maybe I can just pray as we start. Father, we thank you that your word is living because you are the living God. We pray that now, as we reflect upon your word, that you would bring us all that we need today and for the coming days. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I start, I'd just like to share a few words from Oxford Centre for Mission Studies, because knowing that we were going to be together today, many of our scholars and alumni and staff wanted to share their thoughts with me, and I can't possibly read you and tell you all the things. I will give you a list that I can print out later, someday. But just a few things, because Tim was a faculty, part-time faculty member with us for the last 15 years, seconded by Interserv, which is the same Christian organisation that some here and Tim and Liz and I are part of. And as I read through these different accounts of people's experiences of Tim, there was an incredible consistency about what came through, about what was being shared with me. Tim was your English gentleman. I mean that in the sense of gentle man. He was a gentle man. Gentle, humble, unfussy, self-depreciating. We've heard a little bit about that. An attentive listener. Always encouraging and supporting. A reassuring presence. These are some of the things that were being fed back to me by many people. Academically able, he had a unique blend of head and heart. He could bring the two together. They weren't in conflict for him at all. He combined academic excellence with a deep concern for people and for practical ministry. One of our students wrote that he was a great theological conversation partner. Yet at the same time, he just longed to see people know his Saviour. And as I went through all the comments, two things particularly stood out. The first is that many commented on how Tim was for them, first and foremost, a friend. It's quite something when your students write and they say, Tim was a friend to me. Because of Tim, I was able to do my studies and complete them. One of our staff wrote and said, Tim was the first real friend I had at OCMS. He was someone I could share my heart with, knowing that there would be no judgment. He was a friend. But certainly, it's already been spoken about, he had this wicked sense of humour, and this came through constantly in the things that were shared back with me. There was always a twinkle in his eye. Someone wrote, one of the staff wrote, whether exam board or informal conversation, even in the most difficult conversations, they were laced with humour and constructive critique. One of the students wrote, he couldn't hurt a fly, even in the most tense atmosphere of academic argument. All right, and academic communities can be a bit, shall we say, feisty at times. Well, we know that Tim was loved his sport. We in OCMS never really saw Tim the sportsman, I have to say, but he certainly talked a lot about rugby and cricket, which I suppose is the quintessential English sports, although, yes, many people now play them, both of them, a lot better than we do. Tim had this sense of fun, this sense of humour, often at his own expense. And remarkably,
something in you. He found someone not only who appreciated his humour, but entered into it. And one of the most remarkable things I read was from one of our female colleagues who described how on ringing your home, she heard you say at the other end, "Tim, it's girlfriend number one." You have a wicked sense of humour and you shared it with him. You know, some geek Tim adored you. He used to sometimes describe you as "she who is to be obeyed." But it was his humorous way of saying how much he respected and loved you. And you meant the world to him. So we will miss Tim greatly at First EMS. His warmth and the fact that as one person put it, Tim made OCMS feel like a second home for me. We thank God for him. We really are grateful for this colleague, mentor, and friend. Now I want to turn to Philippians, the passage that we just heard read to us, and say just a few words about this. The Apostle Paul writing in Philippians is writing from a very difficult situation because he's in prison. He's in prison and his life is at risk. He's really not sure that he is going to get out of this Roman prison. In fact, he thinks that death may well be the outcome. And to make matters worse, there are people on the outside doing things to make things even more difficult for him. And yet, he rejoices. He rejoices in prison. How's that possible? Why? Because Paul says, because I am here, people are hearing about Jesus Christ who might otherwise not have heard about him. Jesus is being proclaimed because I am here. And he's confident, one way or another, that he's going to be delivered. Either physically, he's going to walk out of that prison released, or through death, he is going to be freed into the presence of God. For Paul, prison facing death was a win-win situation. And as I read this text, and I thought about the two of you and the journey that you have been on together, particularly over the last 16 months, I mean, and how in the prison, if you will, of hospital, both of you took every opportunity to share who Jesus means to you with countless hospital staff, doctors and nurses, physios, other patients, their relatives, in fact, anyone around you. I'm reminded of the way Paul starts the passage we had read. Because of my chains, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly. You know, that was the impact of your witness the last 16 months on us in OCMS. The staff commented as we prayed for you week by week, their sense of commitment to wanting to share Christ because of your example. We have been inspired by what we saw in you. And the confidence that the Apostle Paul has in his future leads him to make a most remarkable statement. He says this: "For me, to live is Christ, but to die is gain." For me to live is Christ. To live is Christ. But to die is gain. You know, lots of organizations have purpose statements, and we live in an age where individuals are now encouraged to have purpose statements. Did you know that? You're supposed to have a purpose statement in your life. Well, long before the management gurus were around, the Apostle Paul had a purpose statement. For me to live is Christ. That was it. To live is Christ. Notice there's nothing about himself in that statement. There's no, I want to do the best I can, I want to leave a legacy, and all of those kinds of things. If you go online and look at personal purpose statements, they've got it. But no, for all it is simple, it is simpler to live is Christ. And later on in this letter, he describes what that means a little bit more fully. He says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship shared in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. To know Christ so intimately that his life was infused with the resurrection power of Jesus, and at the same time, in sharing Christ with others, to be willing to pay whatever it costs. People's personal statements change over time. And you know, the Apostle Paul didn't always think like this. There was a time when the Apostle Paul would have said about his personal statement, I want to be perfect in every possible way I can in obeying God's law. Or today, someone might rephrase that, I want to be the best kind of person I can be. That's how the Apostle Paul, before he met Christ, would have described himself. But then he encounters Christ, he meets Jesus, and the light of Christ that then transforms his life is so powerful it leaves him blinded for 3 days. And he moves in his purpose from living my best self to Christ, living for Christ. And as Reverend Joe pointed out to us earlier, Tim came to that living experience of Christ while he was at the university, immediately threw himself into studying the Word of God, learning hundreds of Bible verses so that God's Word took root in his life. And so he told me that after training and working as an accountant for a while, he was sitting listening to a sermon, and it was so poor. I hope none of you, by the way, did this after this meeting. It was so poor that he decided that he would go and train in theology and become a pastor himself. So there you go, maybe a call for you after today. But he trained, as we heard, and eventually leaving his accountancy, ended up gaining his PhD in New Testament studies. And when we go into the academy, it is very easy for people to make their academic studies and their academic work the focus of their life, but not so Tim. He was a good scholar, he was a fine scholar. But in the end, his deepest desire was simply Christ, to know Christ and make him known. So Tim's life was turned upside down at university. Of course, a number of years later, at the age of 46, his life was turned upside down again. Met his beautiful wife. And this year would have been the 25th of their wedding. And some of you, like Tim, were willing to leave the comfort of your own home, security of your own culture, come to the UK because you believe God was calling you to study. That's where Liz and I first met. 1987, at All Nations Christian College. We've watched since then, and there's been a consistency in your life and your lives together in wanting to know Christ. But God could not have given Tim a better partner in marriage and in ministry than you. He was so grateful for you. This ministry, which in a way was demonstrated so powerfully through those last 16 months, in the prison of a body that no longer serves him and served its purpose, in that prison, nonetheless, radiant with a desire to share Christ. Interestingly, the Apostle Paul's personal statement goes beyond a statement for life. For me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. And I want to close just with these few thoughts. To die is gain. There's a professor in clinical psychology at Stanford Medical University. His name is Irvin Yalom. He's interviewed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of his patients to find out what is most important to them in life. What are their ultimate concerns? And he came up with four ultimate concerns, and the fourth is death. That concerns us. And he wrote this: the terror of death is ubiquitous, and of such magnitude that a considerable portion of one's life energy is consumed in the denial of death. That's a complicated statement. So, very simply, he says, the fear of death is found everywhere. It grips us all, and it's so strong that we end up spending a lot of our energy simply denying that we're going to die. That was the fruit of his research. And you know, from my own personal experiences, as you get older, the recognition of one's mortality becomes more and more clear. And yet the Apostle Paul is freed from that fear. And he could say, for me, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. It's gain. And you know, I'm very confident that Tim would say the same. How on earth is it possible to come to such a place of freedom?
Well, elsewhere in the Bible, in the book of Hebrews, we read that we, human beings, have flesh and blood. So Jesus also shared in our humanity, so that by his death, he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free all of those who lived their lives in slavery to the fear of death. So the writer to the Hebrews, writing 2,000 years ago, knew what Professor Yalom discovered more recently, that all of us are gripped with the fear of death, that it has a power over us. But Jesus, by becoming one of us, by confronting death, and passing through death and having victory over it through his resurrection, leads us out of our fear. That is why Jesus could say, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Jesus is the one who frees us from the power of the fear of death. Jesus is the one who can lead us to the point where we can say, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. I want to leave us with this thought that I believe Tim would really long for every one of us to walk out here today, firm in the conviction that we don't need to be held by the fear of death. We can be free from that, all of us. We can live confident in the knowledge that Jesus has conquered death and united with him in Christ, we too are set free. This is John, Reverend Jerry, Stanley Flatt. We do share in your loss, and separation is painful. To be assured of our love and support, not just now, but in the days and weeks and months ahead. And know this, that Christ holds. Christ holds you. And Christ holds Tim. We do not speak to Tim now, but he is simply on the other side of Christ who holds you. And you remain one with him. And God give you courage and confidence in him in the days ahead, and all of us the ability to stand, for us to live as Christ and to die as King. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you that this is the truth, that in you death has been conquered. In you there is life. We thank you, living God, that Tim did not discover resurrection life when he passed into your presence. He discovered it back in university when he surrendered his life to you. And we pray now for all of us, especially for our sisters and son, the family members, that we, together with them, would know your comfort and strength, and this confidence that you reign in life. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you beginning to really get a flavour of who Tim was?
He didn't make a big noise,
a huge impact on many people's lives. Sometimes just for a moment. Sometimes just for a moment. And so let's stand for him to sing our third hymn, which very much says, to God be the glory. That was what Tim would want. Share the glory of God with others. Let's stand. Every so often, things don't quite go as planned, and we just need to be patient here. One of the things I think that comes through in this is that Tim wouldn't be offended by an hospitality. He'd actually have a laugh about it. That was the nature of who he is. And so I'm going to ask these lovely people to come up and speak.
It's my great joy and honor to stand before you to talk about my relationship and experience with Tim and Sonny. And they are very, very close and old friend of mine. And it's my great joy that I just enjoy the fellowship with him and reflecting on the times that we spent together in our ministry, in our fellowship. I can think of him as a man of God. I'm a church pastor to this Jesus Disciples Community Church located at Race Bus Station, just across from the Race Bus Station. There, every year at the Christmas season, we usually invite Tim and Sonny to deliver a message of Christmas. And whenever we invite to give chance to deliver a message about the coming of Jesus, and it really touches all the hearts of all the listeners, all the congregation, and also it challenges to much about welcoming and prepare ourselves to accepting him in the future to come. And now, even he has passed away from us, and it is a great sadness, and it is a great loss in our ministry and life. But still, Sonny is with us. And when I thought about his leading, Tim's leading from us, and I said to Sonny, that still you are with us, and I trust you that as long as you are with us, we will never leave you alone until the day of Jesus. And now, dear friends, dear congregation, there is, in a sense, it's a time of loss, a time of sadness, but on the other hand, it's a great joy that we just to look to each other and encourage each other, that we think of him and we follow the step of him, that as he has shown us the life like Jesus, and we also follow him and be like Jesus. And I want to give chance to my wife to say about Eric Brick?
Forgive me, I'm speaking in Korean. 한국말로 말씀드린 것을 죄송합니다. 지금 팀 선교사님을 너무 사랑하고 지금 이 순간에도 너무 그랬습니다. 너무 보고 싶습니다. 김 선교사님이 정말 너무 유능하시고 언제든지 뵐 때마다 항상 웃으시고 친절하셔서 우리 교제하고 있는 우리 성도들과 또 모든 선교사님들 얼마나 사랑하는지 모릅니다. 그분께 함께 얘기를 나누고 있으면 정말 친오빠 같고 뭐든지 받아줄 것 같은 친절함에 항상 같이 얘기할 때마다 예수님의 푸근한 성품을 많이 경험할 수 있었습니다. 지금 이 자리에서 팀 선교사님의 웨어웨어 서비스에 참석한다는 것 자체가 아직도 실감이 나지 않는데 언젠가 정말 저도 하나님께서 언젠가 부르시면 주님 앞에서 우리 팀 선교사님을 다시 만나실 때 뭐가 그렇게 급하셔서 먼저 그렇게 일찍 가셨냐고 여쭤보고 싶을 정도입니다. 그분이 이제 가셨지만 정말 그 귀한 선교사님이 살아셨던 그 모든 그 삶의 방식이나 예수님을 사랑하시는 그 사람을 참 많이 닮고 싶었는데 닮은 모습으로 뭐 여전히 이 땅에 남아있는 저와 또 성도들과 함께 그분이 하셨던 일들을 그런 귀한 사역들을 계속해서 진행해 나가려고 합니다. 여전히 우리 사랑하는 여성의 선교사님과 깊은 교제가 20년 넘게 있는데 사랑하는 선교사님과 또 계속 교제해 나가면서 하나님의 귀한 성품들을 서로 나누며 귀한 교제를 나눠갈 예정입니다. 정말 하나님께 이 귀한 예배를 통해서 큰 은혜를 누리하실 주님께 영광을 올려드립니다. 감사합니다.
And darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing there around me heard this, they said, listen, he's calling Elijah. Someone ran. Filled the sponge with wine vinegar, put it on the staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down, he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion was stood there in front of Jesus, so how he died is that surely this man was a son of God. Amen.
That moment is still in the incredibly shocking scripture to bring at a point so poignant in this service. But for Timothy, it would have summed up what Jesus has done for us. He died on that cross and called out to his father, why have you deserted him? Because that's how it felt. But God hadn't deserted him, because we know that wasn't the end of the story. If it was, we wouldn't be here. Jesus rose again, and he went up into heaven, and is there interceding at God's right hand for us. And that is the faith that Tim and Sonny had and has. Yes, it was finished. That's fair. The new has come. Glory to him. first time. Blessed assurance. Jesus is my stand of your life. We're going to have two things one after the other. One's going to be a video clip. Isn't modern technology so good at times? In this case, it is, because we're able to hear from Dr. Wong Lee, principal of Global Ministry Network, speaking in South Korea. Isn't that fantastic? We can hear it, that word. And then I'm going to ask David Watson from InterServe to come and speak after Dr. Mohammed Lee has spoken. So here we go.
Hello, greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Preacher from the land of Morning Come, Korea. My name is Daniel Lee. I am the founding pastor, now emeritus pastor of Global Mission Baptist Church in Korea. Today, we want to bless and honor Reverend Dr. Tim King for entering heaven. Reverend Dr. Tim King is a dear friend whom I share a big part of my life with. I also have known his wife, Sunny, since her youth. She was the best female gospel witness I met while I was serving Seoul Memorial Baptist Church as senior pastor. I would say King's marrying her was the seed of his misfortune. I know that I believe he was saved due to the grace of God, but I believe he became an evangelist due to the pressure and prayer of Sami. Pardon me for opening this memorial speech with a humor, since Brother Tim King himself was the master of humor. He was the man of faith and man of humor as well. I treasure the memories of short trips that I took with Sami and Tim in UK and Korea, laughing and persecuting each other. When Tim received ordination as an evangelist in the Global Mission Baptist Church, where I was the pastor, and I was there with him. Later, Tim came to Korea as a representative of the UK to celebrate the groundbreaking of Pilgrim's Progress Theme Park in Pilgrim House in Korea. He was generous in supporting many, many students from all over the world studying at Oxford Mission Center. More than anything else, he was a friend to those whom Sami shared the gospel to, and those who turned away from other faith to Christianity. He also helped me when my first son, Daniel Huang, became sick during his theological study in UK. In reading Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan, Christian met two very special friends. One is faithful, another is hopeful. For the first half of the journey, faithful accomplished Christians. For the other half, hopeful completed the journey with him. Christian's first friend, faithful, is martyred at Vanity Fair. In this scene, we get to question why God had called him and could not let him live longer. Today, we ask the same question to God. Why did God call him when there is so much left for him to do? And yet, we are confident Reverend and Dr. Tim King will keep working with us as hopeful. Yes, he will be our hopeful to protect Sami and give hope to countless friends who encountered God through them. From this confidence, we can send him to heavenly with a big smile, as we always did. For the dear friend, brother, who was both faithful and hopeful, who now sits next to Jesus, sharing his humor. Again, we want to give our deepest condolences to Sami family and Tim's family as well. She will be missed very much by all of us. We will remember him forever. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Sisters and brothers. My name is David Watson. I'm a partner with Interspurs Mission, and Tim was an elder brother to me in the mission, not just because he joined before me, not just because he was older than me, but because he was a role model for me in the way that he ministered and served. So he gave me greetings on behalf of Interspurs Global Community. I would love to list all the people that bring greetings, but somebody said I only have 3 minutes. So I cannot use that. She asked me a better it's not just by Tim, but from all of us. I was struck that so many people have mentioned the word friend to describe Tim. Paul talks about it, the others have mentioned that Tim was a friend to many. Now, one of the things that Tim and Tony were very involved in was a course called Friendship First, a course to help ordinary Christians, people like us, through friendship, to share something of the love of Jesus with our Muslim friends and neighbors, work colleagues, or family members. But he didn't just promote it and teach it as a course, he lived it in his own friendships. He lived it through the friendships that he and some he had in their local community, friends they made as neighbors or people around, random strangers they bumped into from time to time, but they made friends and invested in love and faithfulness, walking with them through life and sharing the goodness of Jesus through their friendship with many. And Tim had the joy of seeing several come to know and love the Lord Jesus through the friendship that he had with them. Tim inspired us of what it was to be a good friend, and he inspired us of what it was to share the love of Jesus through friendship with those that don't know. Tim was also keen to disciple those who follow Jesus from different faith or cultural backgrounds. Again, not only teaching that through London Bible School or through OCMS, but also through his friendships, through regular Bible studies that he held with people at distance and close, encouraging believers from different countries and backgrounds over many, many years, faithfully investing in people's lives, encouraging God's church through the nations. In fact, he was way ahead of most of us in this desire to serve global Christianity, in this desire to be involved with Christians from other countries. In fact, so keen to demonstrate this, Tim took a wife from another culture and another background also. And that marriage was also an inspiration to us. I didn't know that it was 25 years of marriage that you would be celebrating this year, the same as my wife and I. And we've always looked at Tim and Sogi as a role model for us. The way they showed devotion to one another, loved one another, served faithfully together with one another, laughed with one another, and sometimes at one another, as being a role model for us. His faithfulness and service. Your team embodied so many of these values that we as it deserve hold dear. He was for us such a remarkable and faithful servant, serving believers of other backgrounds, revealing the love of Jesus to Muslims, Hindus, friends, neighbors, anybody that he met, that they might know the precious Lord Jesus that he also knew. And he always sought to pass on to anybody and everybody what he had experienced and knew through teaching and training. You know, many people teach and train, but Tim didn't just train and talk about these things. He lived them in his life, and for that, he was a role model to all of us. Thank you, Brother Tim, for your faithfulness and for inspiring us all.
thanks to technology, we can have the Father in peace. Because unfortunately, David, who was going to do this here today, took the book ill. And so we've got some pieces to play to you now that were recorded and sent through to us. So let's do that. And then I'm going to ask Trazia to come and read for you Psalm 100. Thank you.
To come up on stage to give her tribute. Now that might seem a surprising thing to ask someone from the chorus center. How can you give her a sort of impact and have even in the first thing?
Everybody. And I'm one of the many last fellow in my hair from Google School. The team was admitted on the 25th of June last year. And we looked after him. We have the Google team and had the opportunity to give Tim the best care that we always endeavor to give all our patients. Everyone said Tim was a lovely man with an astonishing sense of humor and had a very distinctive smile. Even when you entered the room without saying a word, you could still smile. When I personally looked after him, before that, the wife simply would come in and call him a rope, a rope, a rope. So I started building a rope. Until he said, no, it is husband and wife. I told him that you are a woman one, wow. And I'm a woman two. And it was somewhere it was. Because everybody would come and oh, Tim, you're both, so we both loved him. So when we looked after him, of course, the one thing I remember mostly about him is his baby boy. When even when he was at his lowest point, when he played the church music, he had a phone on his table, and we all knew, the whole hospital knew the password. You open it, put on the music, and that would cheer him up. But the music has to be at a low voice, not loud. So, if you like the hint, it's great. Input was not solid. At one point in the back, Tim looked disturbed and comfortable and was trying to get out of bed. We were wondering what was wrong with him. It was not me looking at him, but it was one of my colleagues. Tim, the lady tried, Tim, what do I need to do for you? He said, money. So, looking around, the last revival, I asked Tim, do you want me to read you the Bible? Tim said yes. Then the lady asked, what do you want me to read for you? Tim answered, read me some Alfred Emmanuel. So the nurse read him one of that psalm. And he did. Tim said, I knew that when we go here grieving and mourning his departure, even the other hand is in a much better place with his maker. is looking down on us and feeling sorry for us who are living in this very unpredictable and confused world we are in. To the family and friends, I hope you find joy and comfort in knowing that Tim lived a good life. And as the Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, Timothy has fought a good fight. He has finished his race. He has kept the faith and the crown of righteousness of my sin. My Timothy's soul, rest in glory. Thank you very much.
I hope you've started outgrowing got the flavour of who and what. To what made who what he was. There is great sadness, particularly for friends and for family. In respect, my connection with Tim, I knew him. It was tenuous until he went into hospital. And then, at various crisis points, I had the privilege, I call it privilege, I had no other calling upon the privilege to go and minister. There were times when Tim could not respond. You could see him trying to say something. You could see him taking it in. But every so often, there'll be that mini miracle where somehow or other those words will come out. The toll of his faith in Jesus. George has had the delight. Kings had the delight, the plural sangs had the delight of having Tim come and stay with them. For that it would be onerous. There were challenges as patients, and yet Tim and somebody was able to witness time and time and time again. People from the poorest center are just now, but just a few of them. Wherever he went, with Sonny being there by his side, they had an impact on those people's lives. Some would have just got on with their stuff. They reached out and touched many people's lives because that was who Tim was. That's who Sonny is. For Elizabeth, the challenge of seeing a brother, yet she stayed strong. And so we're coming to that time where we're going to say goodbye to Tim. Or rather, should we say goodbye? Because this is not the end. It is for us in the physical sense. Some of us will be going down to the crematorium. You're more than welcome to join us. We are limited in numbers. 200 and 120 per day. Those of you who don't want to go, that's fine. You can stay behind and have tea, coffee, some biscuits. And then for those invited, there'll be a reception hall after the committal at 4. If you're wondering what the collection is going to be, it's going to be for OCMS, that's the Oxford Centre for Mission Studies, and also for Interserve. You can find the connection with that in the programme, there's a website, or contact somebody or Elizabeth, I'm sure we can get funds on those donations. I'm going to do some words of committal, and then the Reverend Chris Folk is going to say a blessing. And at that point, we're going to say farewell, say to me, offering out the church. You've got time, you don't have to rush to find your coffee going down to the crematorium, right? We had to allow time because of schools out. Unfortunately, timings are such that we had to work our way around that. So if that seems a little time late, don't worry. But don't leave it too late, otherwise you will get caught up with the school traffic. But Elizabeth, Jonathan, somebody in the family, those who invited would love to see from the reception. And so we come to that point and say, let us pray. Gracious God, by your power, you give us life in Christ Jesus. In your love, your goodness, new life. We entrust him to your keeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, your and our Lord, who died and rose again for us, to bring us all to a joyful resurrection and the glory of your eternal kingdom. Amen. Jesus said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Loving God, we long for peace. Peace to leave Tim with you. Peace to strengthen us for today and tomorrow and in the days to come. Peace with ourselves and with one another and with you. Grant us that peace that the world cannot give us through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
You don't understand, that's where I find this. For family, friend, neighbour, colleague, fellow missionary, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. May the Father, whose glory fills the heavens, gather you into his holy love and send you out to proclaim his word. Amen. Christ our Saviour, who ascended into heaven, supply all your need by his richness in glory and turn your heart to obedience. Amen. The Holy Spirit, the Comforter, comes to all you. Equip you and strengthen you. Amen. And the Lord Jesus says, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
So, your regrets are kind of going to let us here. We're going to go out to a rousing hallelujah chorus. That's what Tim would want. Hallelujah.
Thank you.